So it gives me great pleasure to return to the BIA. And invited to give a Dhamma reflection. I like to, words like giving a talk or a sermon, words that I really relate to, because Buddhist teachings are much more about reflecting on life rather than telling you what life is about. So it's much more, it's a teaching to encourage you to wake up and to examine, to get to the causes of suffering and to see for yourself rather than telling you what you should do, what you should be. Most of us come from backgrounds where we're, you know, cultural, religious conditioning is about being told what's right and wrong, good and bad, and what to believe in. And so that sometimes in the Buddhist world, when we come to it, those of us who are not Thai, who were not born into Buddhist families, we tend to approach Buddhism with the same attitude that we have acquired from our own cultural conditioned background. And this year, next year, 2016, it'll be the new year soon, the BIA wanted to emphasize the Buddhadāsa's entreaty to please return to morality. And this word morality is a kind of tendentious word in English, because it means being told what's right and wrong. And so, I mean, I've known people who are very well educated, even practicing Buddhist meditation, who as soon as you mention the word morality, they think of it as some kind of heaven and hell kind of threatening you with punishment if you're immoral or whatever. So there was a kind of rebellion. I remember when I was young in the 60s, there was tremendous rebellion against morality as such, because it was like an imposition of orders from above telling you how to act. And the thing that attracted me to Buddhism very much was the fact that sila, the word sila, translated into English as morality, is not about being told what's right and wrong, but it's agreements on action and speech, how to take responsibility for how we live with our families, with ourselves, with the society we live in. The animal world, the law of the jungle, doesn't have moral principles to go by, because they can't decide, they can't agree on not killing each other. It's just part of the nature of survival of the law of the jungle. The animal kingdom is like that. It's the big fish eating the little ones and so forth, and that's the law of nature. But as human beings, we have this reflective ability, and this is what the Buddha emphasized in his instructions. It's a kind of wake-up call, really, to wake up and really look at life in a direct way, not through prejudices, cultural, ethnic, religious prejudices or biases, or through various other distortions, but awaken to reality. So in the West, you know, I lived in England for many years, teaching there, and they'd say, how would you define Buddhism? What is it? What is its main teaching? I said, the Buddha says, "Awake to reality. Wake up." In other words, it's about waking up rather than a whole list of laws and regulations that you have to keep without waking up. It's not that high principles, high standards, and moral precepts are nothing wrong with them, but they tend to be presented in a way that we don't wake up, we merely conform out of fear, out of habit, out of just to fit in, out of fear of going to hell if we're bad, or fear of rejection in the society we're in. And we may not even notice this fear that haunts us, through just fear of when somebody dies, for example, where did they go? And the word death in English is a scary word, because I remember years ago I had a book called Path to the Deathless, and they wouldn't print it because it had the word death in it. They had to change the title, and I said, well, it's deathless, it's not, you know, it's positive. It's a but they said, well, in other words, they changed it to mindfulness, path to the deathless. That seemed to fit their desire, because the word death is frightening to us. Because why are we frightened of death? Because we don't know what happens. None of us do. I've just come back from India, by the way. I mean, we have various theories about what happens when somebody dies, like reincarnation or rebirth, or you go to heaven or hell, or you just are obliterated, nothing happens. Once you're dead, there's nothing more. But the truth of this very moment, when we're sitting here in this hall, is that we don't know what happens when we die. We will when we die. And so this is a direct knowing. It's not about what others tell you what happens, or even no matter how wise or how important these people might be, the direct knowing is that right now I'm experiencing life, the life force through this body, consciousness. This is what the reality of this moment. It's not death. And so death is the unknown for us. And that unknown can make us very uncomfortable, because we'd like, some people prefer various scenarios. Oblivion is one, you know, when you're, doesn't matter what you do, because when you're dead, that's it. There's nothing more. Then there's the possibility of, if you've been good, you go to heaven. If you've been bad, you go to hell. That's scary, because then we fear, we can worry about things we've said, or even thoughts, bad thoughts that have passed through our mind that might send us to hell when we die. And we can think of anything you want, any variation, permutation on the thinking ability. And if you're not aware of what you're doing, then of course you can be good because you're afraid of going to hell, rather than being good because you love the good, you know. Where when you wake up, when you're awakened to reality, to Dhamma, then one's good because one loves the good. It's not because of a fear of being punished or being bad. And this you have to prove to yourself, you know, through mindfulness, through the mindfulness practices that the Buddha emphasized, through reflecting on the Four Noble Truths. This can be seen very clearly for yourself. coming back from India, we spent the past 3 weeks there in going to the Buddhist holy places. And India is a very fascinating place. And especially the Buddhist holy places, because I am a Buddhist, and I've developed the teachings of the Buddha over the years. And when I was in Bodh Gaya, for example, they were having this Tripitaka chanting. This is the 11th year for this annual Tripitaka chanting, where the country of Cambodia was sponsoring the event. So every year, a different country, Buddhist country, will sponsor this. So there were thousands of people from Burma, Cambodia, Thailand, Sri Lanka, from India, from all over the place, the Tibetans, because it's a center of where we all recognize as Buddhists that this is where the Buddha was enlightened. So it's a very powerful spot to be in, and it's very noisy, everybody's chanting in different accents, and the Tibetans are blowing trumpets and Japanese are clacking sticks together and things like this. So, you know, you can, you think it would be rather distracting, but I don't find it that way, because somehow there is a camaraderie or a unity of purpose there. We're not there for, you know, worldly desires or anything other than our common, our bond of a belief or trust in the Lord Buddha. And there, of course, is a place where he actually saw the truth. And what did the Buddha actually see? Because before he was enlightened, he was a very strict ascetic. What was it that changed the ascetic Gautama into the Buddha? It wasn't Bodh Gaya, I'm sure, the place. No, just a Bodhi tree there. Earth, fire, water, and air still the same. What is it that he realized that he didn't realize that in 6 years after he left the palace, where he is a life of privilege and power and luxury? You know, the Prince Siddhartha story, where he had, you know, everything he wanted. And then spending the following 6 years as the ascetic Gautama, where he was depriving himself of everything he wanted. You know, so all desires, any kind of sensual desire or anything like that was forbidden or rejected, and to live a life based on alms mendicancy and survival, and developing samadhis, or concentrating the mind. Because if you're an ascetic and you don't concentrate your mind, you just end up suffering. You can't sustain it for very long. What is it that he actually realized under the Bodhi tree? And of course, in the scriptures, it all makes it like the earth shook and the thunder from the sky. And this tends to be, you know, this could have happened, I don't know. But the thing that he realized was as simple as all conditions are impermanent. Now then we can recognize that intellectually. We say, sape sankharani cha, all conditions are impermanent. But we may not really be awakened to that. We don't. We see it in the books, we hear it on tapes, and we hear it in lectures and so forth. So it kind of, it's easy to kind of accept, because it makes sense, even to the most logical atheist or doubter, you know, all conditions are permanent sounds fairly interesting, non-controversial. Or you may be of the kind of saying, so what? All conditions are impermanent. What's so great about that? Because the ego, the sense of oneself and one's ethnic, cultural, social background affect how we see life. And so we want to make our life have meaning and purpose and have some ultimate goal to live for in the future. Or if you're a doubter, an atheist, or one who rejects theories, metaphysics, and theistic philosophies, or rejects religion, then you settle for oblivion. There's nothing, it's kind of pointless. You just eat, drink, and be happy, for tomorrow you'll die and that's the end of it. But that is still a philosophy, an intellectual philosophy that one is attached to. So what is it that you can know now, at this very moment, everyone in this hall, for sure, is that you're conscious, you're experiencing consciousness at this moment. Anyone not conscious? Raise their hand. And this is just pointing out a fact, it's not anything profound. So consciousness is, we tend to see, especially in the Western world, in the non-Buddhist world, or the theistic religious world, that consciousness is in the body. So we even in, you hear on BBC, you hear scientists discussing consciousness, and it's always taken for granted it's within the human body, that the body comes first and then consciousness enters the body and is limited to the form of the body. Where in Buddhadāsa, consciousness is unlimited, has no boundary. It has no shape or form, it's not personal. It's not male or female, it's not Thai or European. But it is reality here and now, we're all experiencing it. I don't have to define it for you, because you can wake up and just recognize this is consciousness that I'm experiencing right now is like this. It's ability to hear, to feel in the present moment. If you're unconscious, if you're dead, then you don't hear and feel anything. It's knowing, it's ability to know, it's a discerning wisdom, it's a universal reality that has no dimension. So we are all experiencing the same consciousness. It's not mine is in here and yours is in your body, wherever you may be. It's one, it's unitive. It brings us all together, all of nature together in one reality. It's a kind of universality, union, unicity. They talk about that, and consciousness is that reality. When you start reflecting in this way, then you begin to see each other and nature itself. We're talking about animals and trees and plants and the climate problems of the present time all become much more pertinent, much more real for us when we don't feel separated and distant from each other, from nature, from the animal world. We feel interconnected is one word they use these days, and because of what? Because of consciousness. And this way, then, what is it? If animals are conscious, the same as we are, why can't they make moral precepts? And then you realize that, and the Buddha emphasized it, that the what they call in Pali the manusya, the human being, we've got animal forms, our bodies function in the same way as the animal world does, as mammalian species, got the same instincts to survival and procreate the species. We still get angry when we're insulted, or we still want to kill somebody that has offended us. We still feel desires to tell lies, deceive, for sexual promiscuity, for whatever. These are all common to the mammalian world. These are animal instincts, and they are what they are. But then the species, say manusia, or the human species, is a reflect, has this ability to reflect on life. And this is what makes us ability to understand ultimate reality or Dhamma, because we can reflect on it. We're not just helpless victims of cultural habits, cultural conditioning, social attitudes, ethnic prejudices, and so forth. We're not just limited and bound into our egos and our personal habit patterns and fears and desires. If we don't wake up, then we are bound and limited by the conditioning we have, by how you see yourself as a personality. How do you see yourself as a person in the Thai society? And they talk a lot about self-respect and learning to, metta practitioners talk about having metta for yourself and having a sense of self-respect is important, and it is. But self-respect comes through reflection, not through just saying, I respect myself. When you live in a way you respect, so you have this foundation of dana sila, generosity and morality as a way of developing self-respect, or hiri otapa, because it is keeping the five precepts makes you one who's taking responsibility for your ability to act in the world, in the society. Being generous, being jai boon, it's kind of Thai cultural pattern of generosity gives a sense of self-respect. Because being stingy, selfish, does not make you respect yourself. It makes you frightened and seeing that wanting to hoard up and keep everything for yourself doesn't bring joy or happiness or peace to your life. So your life will be one of fear and suspicion. So dana, generosity, dana, and then sila, like the five precepts. This gives you this sense of self-worth, because when you reflect, and you're not supposed to just keep five precepts blindly and just give generously without reflection, but the ability to reflect on it. When people come to the monastery where I live, you know, I try to encourage them, and they always come to offer food or requisites to the Sangha. And I encourage them to reflect on the generosity. I want them to not just do it as some kind of ceremonial custom that you do, or you should do if you're a good person, but to actually experience. When you give something to somebody else, without selfish intention of getting rewarded or anything in return, what do you feel like? And only you can know this. It's an experience. It is what I call joy. There's a kind of joyousness in generosity. So you find in Thailand, it has a joyful atmosphere, a lot of it. This impresses Phurangs like myself when we first come, because we aren't used to that. and where the society seems to be very hospitable and generous. We just don't expect that in a society. Because it is a foundation for Thai culture, you know, the Chadok story is a kind of cultural myth, you know, that the Thai culture is very much integrated with, is the story of developing dana paramita, or generosity. And then the sila, we can learn how, we can help what we feel. Sometimes we feel like murdering somebody, or lying, or stealing, or sexual irresponsibilities, and drinking, and we all have these impulses and desires. You know, these are not, but we see them in terms of, if we're keeping moral precepts, we reflect on that it's wrong to tell a lie, so we try not to tell lies. But also to reflect on the fact that we're not just not telling lies because of a fear of being punished in the future life, but because we don't want to tell lies. Honesty is part of our nature. We're, these five precepts reflect that goodness in our, that human beings are basically good beings and loving beings rather than just selfish entities where you've got to look out for yourself, otherwise no one else will care about you. Luang Por Chah had that kind of faith when I first went to England, because before I went to England, this was in 1977, I started worrying about living as a Buddhist monk in England, in London, big city. And I thought, and we're very strict with the Vinaya rules, and so I thought, how can I keep all these rules, like not handling money and things like that, in a non-Buddhist country like England, in a big city like London, and you walk along the street expecting people to give alms? They don't know what you are. And they don't know what you want. And I started doubting, I don't think I could, I don't think I can do it. Serious doubts entered my mind. So I went to see Luang Por Chah one evening, and I told him my fears and doubts, and so he simply said, "You mean, Sumedho, there are no good people in England?" And I said, "Well, I'm sure there are." He said, "Go." So he had no doubt. And I lived in the UK for 34 years and never went hungry. And I could keep the Vinaya without any great effort. It wasn't impossible to keep that standard in a non-Buddhist country. So my respect for the Buddha's wisdom increased. I thought, well, the Buddha lived in India. India is a very different place 2,500 years ago. People were different, and they were, wasn't like modern London or Bangkok. I mean, these are very sophisticated, complicated cities. They didn't have such places 2,500 years ago in India. And this is how the reasoning mind thinks. You're thinking in terms of ancient India and modern London, and then you're caught up in your own cultural conditioning, in the attitudes that you acquire through being brought up in the society and the culture that you're brought up in. Your belief in time in ancient India was like this, and modern England is like this, or modern Thailand is like this, and ancient Thailand is very different from modern Thailand. But we go on and on about our belief in society changing and social mores and political issues, and this is our real world. This is what we believe is reality. Again, getting back to what is it the Buddha realized under the Bodhi tree in India 2,558 years ago, was that all conditions are impermanent, sape sankhara anicca. And that realization wasn't coming from cultural attitudes or cultural biases or any religious biases. It was an insight. It was coming from, it was like gut knowledge. It was profound insight into the nature of things. There's the Buddha, he's no longer ascetic Gautama, Buddha knowing Dhamma, awake to reality. He awakened to reality. He saw reality for the first time, awakened to it. You can't just, and so Dhamma, say, is reality, is what's real at this moment. And ascetic Gautama left behind his own cultural limitations and identities and so forth. He's no longer thinking, I was Prince Siddhartha, my father is a king and my mother is a queen, and that kind of thing. No longer personal history, but he, in other words, sheds all these identities, all these sankharas, all these conditions to pure awareness, mindfulness, awareness in the present moment, timelessness. Now you're recognizing akalika dhamma, timeless reality, rather than ancient India and modern Thailand. These are concepts that we create, and we build a world around these concepts. Ancient India was like this, and modern Thailand is like this, and then we form theories and views, and each one is going to be different. You know, what you think modern Thailand is like and what I may think it is like can be very different. And we can start wars and battles over these issues as they're doing to this present day, so in other places, just around differences of their own creation, their own distorted positions they take on what's real, on what's necessary, on the way things are, rather than letting go of these sankharas, these conditions, in order to realize the oneness behind all the multiplicity of the bodies, the different shapes, forms, species, conditions that are beyond number, but which are all impermanent. Suan Mok and Gong Thep this year, next year, emphasizing Buddhadāsa's entreaty, return. And Thailand needs this. They need the problems, the governmental problems, the political problems, economic problems. They come from this lack of understanding. And each one's going to have different view. Which one is right and wrong? You know, we each have, my view is right and yours is wrong, but this is a sankhara. Sankharas are right and wrong, good and bad. They're very unstable. You know, so you're never going to get a government that's right. You know, you think it's going to be what it is. And then it changes. It can't sustain itself. It might be, you know, very good at first, but other conditions come in and change it. Like Tanjore Kumbhudadat emphasized the teaching, it's a bungee now, which about conditions. When conditions arise, then this is the result. And we don't have that kind of control around conditions. Conditions come and go and change. When you try to control it, you become obsessive, compulsive, mental, unstable mental patient in a hospital taking lithium or something, because you can't You've got to, you can't stabilize your mind. It goes all over the place. And what is right and what is wrong? And good and bad? Are these absolutes? You know, is good, is there an absolute good and absolute bad? Dhamma transcends good and bad. Good and bad arise and cease. They're sankharas. They are what they are. But with the foundation that the Buddha emphasized of dana sila, then our intention is to act on the good. When we have good thoughts, good intentions, good emotions, that's something, that's our active side. How we relate to each other, how we relate to society, to the nation we're living in, to the world in general, is to do good and refrain from doing bad. But we're still going to have bad thoughts, bad desires, unwholesome akusala dhammas, things that arise in the mind, but we don't act on them. But we know them. They are sankharas. They are what they are. And this knowing is a wisdom element, is panya, wisdom, or knowing sankharas as sankharas, whether the quality changes or they can, you know, so that according to other conditions. But the characteristic of anicca, dukkha, anatta is true for all conditioned phenomena, whether it's the sun or moon, or whether it's a momentary thought passing through your mind in the present moment. And then this knowing, this ability to reflect on it, this is the Buddha mind, this is what brings us, our humanity, into fulfillment. It's to be fully human. And not to think of becoming a Buddha, because that's another, creation. I've got to become a Buddha, but to awaken, to learn to recognize that pure awakened consciousness, and respect that. That's Dhamma, Buddha knowing Dhamma. And then the teachings that the Buddha gave us, the Four Noble Truths, is a kind of brilliant teaching, taking dukkha or suffering, something nobody likes or wants, and saying, look at this, look at suffering. Rather than just trying to get rid of it or blame it on somebody else. So the First Noble Truth is there is dukkha, there is unsatisfactoriness, there is suffering, whatever word you want to use to define dukkha. And this is a truth. There is dukkha. But you're not seeing it out there. You can see plenty of dukkha in India. You go through the streets of Varanasi these days, dukkha's all over the place. But you look here, and it's interesting to travel because they don't clean the streets anymore in Varanasi. And looks like a rubbish tip. And then the American side of me, they should clean the streets. And then I'm aware of that, this reaction. They shouldn't allow it. Varanasi is an important city. They shouldn't allow it to degenerate like this. And I see if I hold on to these views, I'm going to suffer, because that my indignation, my righteous conceits, and that. My opinions about what should and shouldn't be, when I grasp them out of ignorance and believing them, then they take me right into dukkha. There's dukkha, it's First Noble Truth. Right here, you know. So you look here. You turn your attention to the mind, to the heart, to the feeling of life. It's like this. And then you say, that's a noble truth rather than a nasty fact. You see the suffering you're creating around your one's own perception of Varanasi. And then you can spend the rest of the time criticizing the place when actually it's a very fascinating city and a sacred city. It's a kind of one of the few really sacred cities left on the planet, is Varanasi. But these are ways for us to examine life, to get to know why you do suffer, why you worry about the future, or feel guilt-ridden about things of the past, or resentful or angry around your life, or disappointed with life, or when even when you're successful and life is just going along fine, everything is just really wonderful, you know it's going to change. You can't sustain it on. Life is absolutely wonderful. And because you know that all conditions are impermanent. So you're not expecting life to be wonderful and make you happy, but you can learn from life as you're living it, the way you are, the way your particular character is formed. The awareness of that character is a universal reality of consciousness and wisdom. You learn to trust that and take refuge in that rather than in how to clean up the streets of Varanasi or how to solve all the problems of Thai society or how to reconcile all the family problems you might have. Because that's endless and it's like trying to clean the streets of Varanasi with a toothbrush. You get a little bit clean and then gets dirty right away. You can't sustain cleanliness. But what is cleanliness? What is purity? Is consciousness itself. It's pure. It's our true nature. It's not something you create. It's not a creation out of ignorance. It's not personal. It's not mine or yours. But it's here and now. And when we begin to, when we awaken to that, then we call that enlightenment or liberation. Liberation from the illusions of the sankharas that before we're blinded by and limited by our attachment to the physical bodies we have, to our emotional habits, to the what we see, hear, smell, taste, touch, and think. So now, if there are any questions, I shall try to entertain questions or be entertained by questions.
กราบนมัสการหลวงพ่อค่ะ A friend of mine, she is very good. She is very perfectionist. She works very well. But now she's got more and more suffering because everything around her, she thinks is desoluted her. Even she, day by day, she's getting more and more and more disoluted of everything around her because she had a high expectation of the thing that should be like that, and her friend, her colleagues should be like that. And how can I guide her on the simple way to get her off of her suffering?
Oh, this is like a case of being attached to ideals. And because you can create ideals with your mind, you know, like You can think of how a perfect Thai society should be, and democratic and free and with justice and equality and all the best. These are thoughts, where you can think to that peak of perfection of how things should be. We can create ideal political systems or social systems, or the ideal wife, or the ideal husband, or ideal children, ideal university. We can all do this, which we do. We tend to think in terms of how it should be. But the Buddha's pointing to the way things are, not how they should be. So that's where, like, mindfulness is not a critical function. It's not saying there's something wrong with the way it is, but it is the way it is. And life is like this, and what I feel. If I feel disappointed, with people I know, or with my profession, or that, it's because I was expecting it much more from it than it was capable of, according to some idea or hope of expectation for the future. But as we grow older, we all become more disappointed with life, because when you're 20 years old, my expectations were very high. And by the time I was 30, 10 years passed, I was really disappointed with myself, with my job and whatnot. But then with mindfulness practice, you're aware of this attachment to high standards, high principles, to ideals of how things should be. And it's not that anything wrong with the ideal. I mean, it's not to not have them, but they're limited. They're not conscious forms. They come and go and they change. And they don't feel anything. Like an ideal society doesn't have individuals in it with different problems, different expectations. It's all about marching in step and everybody paying their taxes on time. And this is this is how it should be. But like Chao Kun Puttat, say Benyang Niang, this is the way it is. It's not something you want, but it once you kind of accept the way it is, doesn't mean you like the way it is, you just begin to feel this sense of relief of not expecting the world to be something that can't be, or dealing with other people, with family members, with your partners and so forth. They are the way they are, and they shouldn't be, but this is the way they are. And that kind of is a relief rather than a cynical statement about, well, what can you do with somebody like that, the way they are? That's cynicism. But Benyang Niang is more like, this is the way things are at this moment. It's like this, and I accept the way it is. Let it be what it is. And and if you're observing your mind, you'll see, you'll feel a sense of relief. You can know it. It's because suddenly you're not the person that's trying to solve every problem and answer every question and make the world right, or be disappointed because the world changes in a way you don't like. You can still accept that reality as it is. So, like the Buddha's teaching has. Like in Varanasi, it's the way it is. And suddenly I wasn't making any problems about Varanasi in my mind. I'm enjoying it. I like the place. But if I just spent the time, it's a rubbish dump and it shouldn't be like this. And being frightened by it or whatever, then I'd be caught in dukkha without any awakening moment. It wasn't that it's not about approving of Varanasi rubbish or liking it, but it's the way it is, and I can live with that.
I remember a few years ago, I read, I believe it was one of your books, where you highlighted the difference between the conventional truth and the ultimate truth, and that the key to finding inner peace was to find the balance between these two. And since then, I've tried to emulate that, but I found that it's quite hard to find balance and find this middle way. And so I would like to ask you, is there some kind of state of mind that you must be in order to find true balance between these two?
Yeah, just reflect. You're living in your experience right now is in the world of sankharas. You're sitting, you're breathing, you're feeling, you're thinking something, and then you know, the conventional reality of it is like this. It's the oh, this chap, yeah. But it's, you know, this is where, like, Luang Por Chah was really good at that, and getting you to bring, touching earth, you know, touching the world, not rejecting it nor grasping it. And so it's seeing it as it is. And so it's like the ultimate reality, paramatta satya, or ultimate reality, is you can't define it, but it knows itself. And when we let go of conditions, let go of our ideas, it doesn't mean we get rid of them. It doesn't mean that we're kind of annihilating anything. But it's a simple act, just like letting go. You know, you're grasping something, then you find you're getting a lot of tension because you're so grasping, and then you just put the watch down, and it's like this. It's kind of relief. And so letting go is part of the Noble Truth teaching, the second Noble Truth. Letting go is more like relaxing, not trying hard, but not, it's about right effort rather than trying too hard or not enough. And this is intuitive. You have to, I encourage you to trust yourself more, because when you think about whether you're really being mindful all the time or whether you're, how successful you are, you're going to get lost in your ego again. You know, so don't, you know, recognize that what you think and your own ego reactions and your own doubts about yourself or about ultimate reality is just creations of the mind. You know, they are sankharas. So you know what they are. They're sankharas. But then just let it be that way rather than trying to figure how much, why am I still so wound up in the conventional reality of life, and because we do have to live with it, you know. You live, even in a monastery, you're living with Vinaya conventions. You have all these strict conventions that the Buddha encouraged us to use. So then, you've got needs of your body, needs to be fed, needs to be rested, and so forth. So you get hungry and you get thirsty, and these are about the way sankharas are. Bodies are like this, and rather than just trying to get out of the body and just live in a world of ethereal bliss, pure consciousness, and there's nothing more to do with the sankharas. That's an ideal, you know. You can think that up in your head, but you can't really do it. Because as long as the body's breathing, then we learn from the noble truths rather than from some ideal you might have, you might admire. So, ultimate realm, Paramattha Satya, knows itself. This is the third noble truth. And Nirodha, it's a knowing of cessation and knowing itself. But you as a person don't know it. You have to let go of the sakyaditti or the self-view to be able to fully appreciate this, the ultimate reality. But it's here and now. It's not something remote or you don't have. It's something so here and now, most people never notice it. Except when crises arise, like physical danger. You notice how mindful you are when your life is threatened. And people like climbing, rock climbing, or mountain climbing, or climbing Mount Everest, or riding motorcycles through obstructions, and doing all kinds of dangerous things. And you ask yourself, why do they want to do that? Dangerous. Because I noticed somebody that was a rock climber told me, because when you're climbing rocks, you don't think. You're just with where your hands are, where your feet are. You're with the here and now, because there's imminent danger there. You know, you're right. You could fall off the cliff very easily, and that would be the end of you. And danger itself gives us that awareness. Like people have told me, amazing stories of what they've done when their lives or their children's lives are in danger, and the kind of things that their physical feats they accomplish or whatever, because of what? Because at that time there's no self; they just respond to the threat. And that's where, but say in much of our life, middle class living, it's all security of safety. You have burglar alarms, watchdogs, CCTV cameras, you've got policemen, you've got army, navy, you've got big doors that lock, we have many locks. And so you're not on a rock cliff with your hands and feet. You're in a nice, comfortable, air-conditioned condo in Bangkok. You can be totally heedless and neurotic, and you'll survive. But on a rock cliff, you can't be neurotic. You can't worry about the future. You're with here and now. And the Buddha, it's interesting why he established the Sangha, because the Sangha lives very much on alms, on samana sanya, and you have all these reflections on living on alms, on trust. And I think, why did he do that? Certainly, he should have allowed us to at least plant vegetables in the garden. I mean, it's sometimes, we could grow our own cabbages and that would make us feel safer. You don't know if you're going to go out and anybody's going to offer anything in the alms bowl. But it's because it's not about security, it's about insecurity but trust in Buddha Dhamma Sangha. That's what it really means. Bhutang Saranangatami is that. It's taking refuge in awareness now, not just ceremonial chant you do when you go to the temple, to the Wat.
I have wonders about the first precept because the friend of mine who is a fisherman, or he kill animal, kill fish, and he say that you are eat fish, so you are not good in the first precept because you are the result of he killing animals. And I'm wondering about this question that is this good to eat animals or not? Thank you.
It's good for your body. Like the first precept of the five is it has different interpretations, but the actual is not to intentionally kill another human being. So this is, you know, have you ever wanted to kill another human being? I have. That something you don't do if you keep the first precept. And then some people expand that to respecting life or fish and chicken and or beef and pigs and whatnot. But actually, the first precept is about respecting life of other human beings. And then in Buddhism, in Theravada Buddhism, it's not a vegetarian religion. And like monks in India, you know, where they've got this caste system, he's trying to break through that caste where the Brahmin castes are vegetarians. And so the Buddhist monks would accept food from low caste or Brahmin. I mean, so you weren't encouraged, I'm a vegetarian, I only accept food from Brahmin families, because then you're supporting a convention again that discriminates. So you're allowing even people who of lower rank or who eat meat to offer food. And they usually offer the best food they have, so oftentimes that includes meat of some sort of fish. And vegetarianism is something to respect, you know, and encourage, but it's not a Vinaya rule because of the mendicancy. And then for lay people, it's up to the individuals how strictly they want to keep the first precept. But I always like to emphasize that because this is where one gets into very opinionated views about food. That you shouldn't eat any meat at all. I've been accused of being wrong because I eat meat and I shouldn't, according to the views of various individuals. I asked Luang Por Chah about it years ago because I was trying to be vegetarian in North East Thailand, where they have very good vegetables there, but they mix numpla with everything. And so that's fish sauce. And I became really obsessed with, you know, does this have numpla in it? You know, it wasn't very nice, you know, people offering their food and you're kind of sniffing it, and no, not that. And so Luang Por Chah, you know, just encourage us to receive food that's offered and without making it into vegetarian situation. Because you don't want to spend your life just worrying about your diet. You know, you... But I encourage vegetarianism, you know, it's like, because it's a good thing, it's good. And so, like, being good is good. But good is another condition, arising ceasing. And so, you know, the emphasis Luang Por Chah made was very on being wise rather than just good. And that wisdom then is much more immediate, spontaneous to the present situation. You know, where when I was obsessed with vegetarianism, I tended to be heedless in situations. You know, like people offering dana, and I'm looking at the food and the fish sauce and rejecting it. That's not being very mindful. I'm actually, you know, taking something people have offered me and making a judgment about, where the aim of a samana, of a bhikkhu, is to receive what's offered in the alms bowl, you know. So then whether it's fish or meat or vegetarian food with nam pla in it.
There's one question that's been passed on from the audience. He gave the questions in Thai. I tried to convert it into English as collectively as I can. He mentioned that would you be able to give guidelines or advice on how to develop anapanasati to be vipassana?
Because anapanasati is like breathing in, breathing out, and you can use that as a concentration practice, you know, to get concentration, but also as a vipassana, to be aware of the impermanence of the breath. Like you breathe in is like this, breathe out is like that, and you can only breathe in so far, and then you have to breathe out. And then this is about all conditions are impermanent. And then that which is aware of the breath, breathing in, is a consciousness. You're consciously focused on the inhalation is like this. And it's not personal, is it? You don't think my, you know, you can think my inhalation, but it's not necessary, because like the breathing of the body is just a natural function. Whether even if you're totally insane, your still body knows how to breathe, and so. But with vipassana, you're using mindfulness and wisdom to observe the way things are. So like with breathing in, breathing out can lead into reflection on impermanence, anicca, dukkha, anatta. In fact, like the breathing, because your ego is not highly involved with your breathing. With your body, maybe you have a strong sense of yourself with what you look like and your age and your gender and all that. But breathing usually isn't about, you know, race or gender or social status. It's like this, you know, it's not even interesting. And but it is happening now, and it's a condition. The body is nature's to breathe, so you can observe. That which is observing the breath is not impermanent. That mindfulness, and you begin to have a continuity of mindfulness. Mindfulness that isn't just a mindful of the rock cliff when you're in danger, or mindful of the breath, but includes everything. So it leads towards seeing the nature of all conditions as anicca, dukkha, anatta. That same, like we have the asupa practices, kesa loma nakadanta taja. When somebody takes the samanera precepts or becomes a bhikkhu, they have to recite kesa loma nakadanta taja, which is hair of the head, hair of the body, nails, teeth, and skin. And this at first becomes more of a mantra, but as you reflect on it, you're reflecting on what most people create vanity, you know, their hair, their teeth, the complexion, the skin, and so forth, creates this sense of, you know, one's physical attraction or vanity or personality. But in when you become a samanera or a bhikkhu, then you're shaving your head, you know, you look all pretty much alike, you know, so you're not, you have to trim your nails down and shave your beard, mustache off, and eyebrows, and wear this kind of orange or yellow or brown robes. So, I mean, the things that arouse like vanity or sexual attraction or a sense of personal acceptance are kind of removed. And then you reflect on that, you know, on that now you're not involved with going to the hair salon or having your nails done. You give all that up. And then the four postures, like sitting, standing, walking, lying down, these are the movements of the body, day and night. You're either sitting, standing, walking, lying down, and you're more aware of the nature of your body is in its movement rather than trying to get perfect postures. It's not about perfect posture, it's about the movement of the body, being aware. Because that which is aware of the body, consciousness, awareness, mindfulness, is aware. The body's like this, just sitting right now like this, standing, walking, lying down for basic postures. So you're bringing attention to the here and now, to the breath as it is, to the four postures. You're aware, and the awareness of the body is changing from personal identity, vanity, and so forth, towards seeing it in terms of it is the way it is. Like when you take hair of the head out of context, you know, you don't, not something that arouses a sexual desire, but beautiful hair can do that. You know, if you spend your time trying to make your hair attractive, it arouses desires in others. But, I'm not condemning that, but like the samana life, you're simplifying everything in order to reflect on it.
Now, when we please, let us all pay the respect to the Triple Gem together.
Can we, the Sangha, give blessing for the new year?
That would be so grateful. Okay. So, Phra Ajahn Thuk Rup ja hai phon pi mai ka pok rao thuk khon ka na ka.
Jayanto Bodhiya Mule Sakya Nang Nanti Vandano E Vangdova Vichayo Ho Hichaya Sujaya Mangale Ambarachita Balange Sise Matavi pokari apiteke sambhabhutanangakabato mamodhaditunakadang sumangalang subhapadang sohodhidang sukhano samuhundho jasuyedha brahmachari subhatakinang Gaya gamang vajagamang vatakinang vatakinang manogamang vanitide vatakina vatakinani tovana lapandante vatakine. So I wish you all a happy new year.